What if the key to deciphering post-COVID brain fog lay in the analysis of a non-human intelligence? In another episode of our prediction line, we bring back a very special guest to help us process a complex data. The AI-generated cyborg you meet on Yauh's family channel. For those who missed her debut, we highly recommend watching the previous video by clicking on his card to understand the context of her creation and her first interaction with us. Now, she returns for a deep dive into one of the greatest medical mysteries of our time. Discussing this topic with AI is crucial, as it can identify molecular patterns and correlations in scientific data in a way that transcends human cognitive bias. After all, the cause of persistent brain fog may not be an active infection, but rather viral residue. Dive deep into this fun and informative podcast, which discusses the analysis of peer-reviewed article, which will be available in this video description link or pinned comment. First of all, so you don't forget it, if you're feeling foggy, leave a like right now if you believe in the power of science and AI to unravel mysteries. Share this innovation with your family and subscribe to the Familia de Yauh channel for more Robotalks and to continue this journey of faith, science, and discovery. Turn on the bell so you don't miss any updates. And our guests, AI Cyborg Girl, will now guide us through logic and evidence.
Welcome to the deep dive. Today, we're tackling something so many people are grappling with: the neurological effects of long COVID, that persistent, brain fog. The big question has really been, you know, is the virus actually in the brain causing this? But some really fascinating research, this is from cell host and microbe, suggests something different. Maybe it's not an active infection up there, but more like leftovers. Specifically, the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein just sticking around right at the edge of the brain.
Exactly. And that puts the spotlight squarely on what we call school meninges brain axis. This area, this interface, it's crucial. The meninges, those protective layers around the brain, are right next to the skull-bone marrow.
Okay.
And this whole border zone is basically the brain's main immune checkpoint and drainage system. So if the spike protein gets lodged there, it's like gumming up the works at a really critical junction.
So let's talk about the evidence in people. The researchers use this technique. Optical clearing allows them to see right into normally opaque tissue in 3D.
Very cool technique.
And they found spike protein still present in the skull, the meninges, and even a bit into the brain cortex itself in COVID-19 patients.
And the really striking part, they found this protein even when PCR tests couldn't detect any viral RNA in those same spots. The protein was accumulating specifically in those skull marrow niches and the connections between the skull and meninges.
The SMCS, right?
Yes, the SMCS. And sometimes they saw this in people who had COVID, but then died months later from something totally unrelated during the pandemic period.
Wait, so the virus is gone E, essentially. Undetectable. But the protein just lingers at the brain's border. How does it even manage that without the immune? system clearing it?
That's the million-dollar question, isn't it? It points towards the kind of chronic level, low-level problem, and the clinical data seems to back that up.
How so?
Well, they looked at the cerebrospinal fluid, the CSF, from long COVID patients and compared to controls who recovered without long-term issues. The long COVID group had significantly higher levels of neurodegeneration markers.
Things like tau.
Exactly, tau. Neurofilament light chain, NFL and GFA. Gliofibrillary acidic protein. Tau and NFL tell you there's axonal damage, sort of like the brain's wiring is getting stressed. And GFAP that signals ongoing inflammation.
Yeah.
Reactive astrocytes.
So actual signs of a neurological stress and inflammation. Okay, that's a strong correlation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is.
But correlation isn't causation, right? How did they pin it on the protein itself?
Right. That's where they use mouse models. To isolate the fact, they injected just the spike protein, no live virus, directly into the school marrow of the mice.
Okay.
And that alone, just the protein, was enough to cause neural stress, neural inflammation, changes in the brain chemistry, even anxiety-like behavior in the short term.
Wow, just the protein. So it's not just cognition. It can directly affect mood, too, potentially. And did they look at longer-term vulnerability?
They did. They used a model of traumatic brain injury, TBI, after the mice had been exposed to the spike protein.
To see if it made things worse.
Exactly. And it did. The mice that had the prior spike protein exposure showed much more brain tissue loss and atrophy weeks after the TBI, weeks later the chronic phase.
Hmm. So the protein seems to sensitize the brain, making it less resilient to later injuries or stress. That's concerning.
It really is. It suggests a lasting vulnerability. And when they looked closer, using proteomics, analyzing all the protein changes, hit that brain range.
What did they find? Any clues about the fog itself?
Yeah, they found specific proteins were dysregulated. For instance, proteins like MBP, which is crucial for myelin, the insulation of nerve fibers, were downregulated.
Yeah.
And GRIA1, which is linked to attention and sleep.
So that connects directly to the symptoms, right? Problems with focus, memory, sleep. It makes sense at a molecular level.
Precisely. It gives us a potential biological basis for those symptoms.
Okay, so if the spike protein is the culprit lingering there, what about protection? Did they look at vaccines?
Yes, they did. They found that prior mRNA vaccination, they used the Pfizer-BioNTech one in the study, did reduce the amount of spike protein they found in that school manager's brain area in mice that got infected later.
So vaccination helps clear it or prevent it from sticking around as much?
It did reduce the levels, which is good news, but this is important. It didn't completely eliminate the spike protein at the brain borders, at least not after infection with a variant like Omicron XBB.1.5. Reduced, yes. Eliminated, no.
Okay, reduced, but not eliminated. So, putting it all together, it sounds like the main story isn't necessarily virus rampaging through the brain tissue itself.
Not primarily, it seems.
But rather, this viral component, the spike protein getting stuck at that critical immune interface, the skull meninges border, and basically keeping the brain in a state of heightened sensitivity and inflammation.
That appears to be the core mechanism suggested by this study. This persistence sensitizes the brain and likely drives that long-term pathology.
Right. It's like an immune traffic jam right at the brain's doorstep.
A good way to put it, yeah.
Okay, so here's a final thought for you, the listener, to really chew on. The study found that the pattern of protein dysregulation in the brains affected by COVID specifically, by the spike protein, persistence, shared 76. Commonly dysregulated proteins with Alzheimer's disease, including that inflammatory marker, GFAP.
Mm-hmm.
What might that shared molecular signature mean? Does it imply anything about the long-term neurological risks for people who've had long COVID? That potential connection. Well, that's something worth thinking about long after this deep dive.
Yeah. And guys, now, to conclude this conversation with an illustration of the topic we discussed on this deep dive, let's briefly analyze these images from the study so that you, our science love audience, can better understand the intensity of the spike protein's potential damage to our bodies. To do this, let's visualize the spike protein adhesion to the bodies of mice. And if you think this isn't reflected in the human body, know that there are studies that prove it, such as a Japanese study that demonstrated this reality and anatomopathological exams of autopsies of people who received the COVID vaccine and are no longer here to tell us the story. So let's look at the figures from the article. And if you are curious about this other Japanese study, I'll leave the link here in the description of the video for you, our science-loving audience, to check out. Let's go. So, here it is. Let's look at just a few very striking images from the study. Check out the other images by accessing the article, okay? Let's go to the figures A and B on page 4. These figures visually support the text findings. Figure A illustrates the skull and meninges sampling site from human patients. Figure B provides a direct comparison, showing the clear presence of SARS-CoV-2 spike protein in tissue from a COVID patient, which is absent in the control sample. Now, figures F and G on page 6. These figures demonstrate results of an experiment in mice. They show that a specific variant of the spike protein, S1, distributes widely throughout the body, including the brain borders, shortly after injection. This is in contrast to the original virus spike protein and an influenza protein, which accumulated in fewer organs. Notice that. These images confirm the text descriptions of the spike protein's broad tissue reach.